information that we've gathered over the years. As what our president mentioned earlier, this is a very, very timely topic for us to discuss. The RRM has been in the airways, it has been mentioned by politicians and ordinary citizens alike. And so probably it's just apt for us to go deeper in terms of how we are doing policy-wise, implementation-wise, and how our stakeholders within the Philippines, within the country, are contributing or are flourishing or probably in some cases having some difficulties in terms of being in sync with the disaster risk reduction management effort in the Philippines. So we have titled this morning's presentation with this question: have we institutionalized the RRM in the Philippines? It's a big controversial, but I probably could assure you that that the result would be not that unpalatable to take. It's really, I guess, a qualitative description of how we are faring in terms of having this institutional setup that is catering to disaster risk reduction and management. Agency-wise, and within the totality of the bureaucracy as a whole. So let's start. Okay. Just to streamline the presentation, what you have here is the outline of what I'm going to talk about. First is the premise behind the RRM in the country. Second, you have your policy backdrop. Third, what resources do we have for the RRM? Fourth, what are the institutional arrangements in place? And the fifth one would be a very general enumeration of the insights that we've gathered. Probably it's worth going back to what Dr. Lianto mentioned earlier. He actually explained properly the premise behind disaster risk reduction management in the country. He mentioned losses. He mentioned the potential of really incurring so much difficulties in times of disaster events. And indeed, over the past few years, we have incurred so much losses, not only in properties, but also in lives. So DRRM may be a very, very short and simple group of words, but really it amounts to or equates to lives and properties. So very, very significant in terms of how we look at it and how we look at how DRRM is being taken institutionally and probably how the citizenry is responding to the bureaucratic efforts towards that. Words probably would not be able to explain the picture is presented in the slide. So Philippine disasters. We are indeed blessed in terms of having so much difficulties, man-made and natural events, actually incur so much losses. If you're going to tally, for example, our yearly losses or casualties in terms of all those disaster events that we encounter almost regularly, it's really depressing in many ways and challenging on the part of our institutions and officials in government, I guess. For ordinary citizens, it's really also a challenge for them to contribute as well as to survive, given what is in place. So we are faced with a multitude of hazards. We are faced with multitude of multiple challenges. And what can we do? Now the government has in place a very, very comprehensive policy backdrop for the RRM. Now we treat the RRM as a separate institutionally with climate change, CCA. Although the two are very much related, and significantly they are tied together, institutionally in the Philippines we are treating those separately. And probably it's reflected in the way we also craft our laws. So you have your Climate Change Act of 2009, you have your DRRM Act of 2010. But essentially, we're talking about the impacts of extreme climate events. We're also talking about matters dealing with DRRM. So risk reduction and management. Probably I'll go into the details of the pillars that is presented in our law, in our policy. But really, it is a cycle. You start with thinking about the risks. You start with mitigation and adaptation. You start with being prepared. And then you respond in times of disasters. And then you rebuild afterwards, given the destruction brought about by events. So these are just pictures of how our stakeholders in the field are doing their part, contributing, trying to ease whatever pains, whatever difficulties our citizenry experience during disaster events. So the Philippines is really disaster prone. You probably all know this. I'll just go through the slide. 20 typhoons annual average, 5 to 9, incurring significant damage. 25 active volcanoes, earthquake and landslide threats. As mentioned by the president, we are the second most disaster-prone country in the world. We are the second most affected by impacts of weather-related loss events. So probably, if you're going to talk about the previous 5 to 10 years, hindi tayo bumababas sa top 5 when it comes to all those risk-related indices. So, it's very apparent if you're going to look at records, figures, and even reports from third-party institutions, organizations, that the Philippines is facing so much risk in terms of natural and man-made occurrences. So probably you can classify the hazards that we are facing in three main categories: geological, hydromet, and man-induced. DOST classifies the hazards as such, and I think it's worth looking at the array of risks, natural or man-made, through this classification. So you have earthquake-related, volcanic-related, landslides, which could also be hydrometric-related. The typhoons, tropical cyclones, floods from them, storm surges, like the Yolanda event. And then, man-induced. Go to Mindanao, go to Marawi right now, and you'll see devastation because of that. Sociopolitical, terrorism, chemical, biological, nuclear, fire, accidents, epidemics. So it's not really just nature giving us difficulties, giving us challenges. It's really us, ourselves, playing a big role in terms of setting the playing field, setting that field of risks for all of us. So we are indeed a nation at risk. I just included this because it's a very, very graphic illustration of what we are facing in terms of natural possible disaster events. Alright, so you have your premise behind possibly managing disaster risk. And probably it's really worth acknowledging that the government has been doing its part. We're going to look at our policy setting, our policy backdrop for DRRM. It's very, very comprehensive. Just take, for example, RA 10121, which was passed in 2010. It's a very good law. And probably if you're going to translate the entry plan, which is attached to that, I don't think we'll ever go wrong, because it's a very comprehensive list of potential courses of action for DRRM. So that's 2010. But probably before that, if you're going to look at the landscape, by default, we were using a very old law. We had that PD 1566 passed in 1978, which was our default DRR policy before the passing of RA 10121. Now, the local government code of 1991 also plays a big role in terms of us having that policy foundation. It strengthens, it aims to strengthen the local government units for them to be able to cope with stresses. And definitely, man-made and environmental stresses are abundant. So if we're going to look at the slide further, you'll see there the chronological entries of policies. So we try to base, well, we try to start with the very old 1978 PD 1566. So you had your National Disaster Coordinating Council back then. Relating that to what we have now, RA 10121, which actually has a parallel organizational structure in place, you'll see that really not much has changed. Probably institution-wise, we are dealing with the same structures. We are probably dealing with almost the same people, almost the same groups of or clusters of organizations in government. But the difference is probably the proactivity that is being enshrined in the new law. So it's probably an open said word. Let us be proactive. Let us not be reactive. But really enshrining that in a law and actually implementing something that is consistent with that is commendable as well as very difficult. So if we're going to look at probably how the law is being grounded, to see there whether there is harmony in terms of what the law says and what's being grounded in the field, what's being translated in our institutions. So just to mention, you have the Climate Change Act of 2009, you have your Climate Change Action Plan, and then you have a revision of the law with the People's Survival Fund in 2012. Globally, you have your Kyoko Framework from 2005 to 2015. When it lapsed, you have your Sendai Framework, 2015 to 2030. Now, the most recent and probably a very talked about series of events, probably the ratification of the Paris Agreement on climate change in the Philippines. Just so, well, just because our president, President Duterte, when he came into office, actually immediately mentioned that he will not sign the Paris Agreement. Fortunately, in March this year, he signed the agreement and the Senate ratified it. So, we are now actually part of that global initiative to address TRR issues, to address climate change issues. And we have access to the Green Climate Fund and so many resources that could actually help us, not only in terms of adaptation, but also in bettering our status as a nation, going for sustainable development, that ideal. So we have very good developments in terms of the CC and DRR framework or landscape. As I mentioned earlier, although very much related, we're talking about climate change, we're talking about bigger issues, gradual changes in climatic parameters, how to address those, how to mitigate, how to adapt. And then you have your DRR initiatives focusing on reducing vulnerabilities, a function of which covers sensitivities, adaptive capacities, and exposure. And in many ways, exposure is a given, but we can minimize our risk, our vulnerability by really strengthening our citizenry, our institutions, as well as any entity that caters to certain important segments in the whole scheme of things. So the slide just highlights the link between the two. So when we're talking about CCA, we're talking about DRR, we're actually talking about family, we're talking about related things. Now, since DRR is the focus of our presentation this morning, let us go deeper into RA10121, the Philippine Disaster Risk Reduction Management Act of 2010. Disregarding everything else, if you just, for example, take RA10121 and its IRR and its National Disaster Risk Reduction Management Plan, you actually have a very, very good package of policy. It can serve as a good umbrella policy for DRR. And I think, in reality, in terms of grounding, it actually happened. Because even if institutions are not reading the entry plan, for example, and if they are actually going through their activities, their mandates, as is, all their DRR-related activities, all of their climate change-related activities actually would fall into one or two of the items mentioned in the entry plan. So it's a good thing because we have a very comprehensive document. Now the challenge would be to use that document and actually benefit from it in terms of crafting institutional initiatives. We'll try to go deeper into that as we present details in terms of how institutions are grounding or translating RA10121 and the entry plan. So just an overview, there are four pillars highlighted in the law. You start with prevention and mitigation, then you go to preparedness, you go to response, when there are disaster events, and then you rehabilitate, you try to recover after that. Now the pillars are very simple if you're going to read, or for example, if you're going to look at the diagram. And it's very easy to understand. But in terms of actually grounding initiatives, it's a bit difficult because you're talking about so many institutions, you're talking about so many organizations, so many individuals, so many decision makers, so many resource constraints. It's not that simple. But what is good is you have a guide, you have a pattern, if ever you want one. So there are co-chairs. Institutions have been identified as respective beats of each pillar, as mentioned here. And probably later on we'll see whether there is comparable resource and initiatives related to what they are supposed to manage or to be involved in. So key strategies were RA-111, advocacy and IEC, competency-based capability building, contingency planning, DRM, CCA education, institutionalization of DRRM councils, local DRRM offices, mainstreaming. We've been mentioning and we've been hearing so much mainstreaming. So what is it? Is it really just a word, or is it comparable to institutionalization, or is it really definable as what? The implantation of fundamental values in organizational culture and functions. That could be it. And I guess the rest of the slides would be pointing towards that. Research, technology development, and knowledge management. The USD has been good in terms of taking in this responsibility. Monitoring, evaluation, and learning, supposedly under RA-101-1, and it's IRR. The MQMC Secretariat, OCD, would be empowered to coordinate and monitor the implementation of the MQMC. Networking and partnership building among stakeholders, media, peers, and government. So very ideal, and then very straightforward. And there is really nothing new in terms of what I mentioned. Those enumerated items, I think, are not new to you as well. So they are very simple crafted phrases, which together will actually give substance to the law. So RA-101-21 and the MDP, probably a good manifestation of how you would implant policy in terms of institutional functions would be to look into the MDP. Essentially, you have the essence or the key objectives of the policy as well as the instrument. So build the adaptive capacities of communities towards sustainable development and inclusive growth, increase the resilience of vulnerable sectors, optimize disaster mitigation opportunities, with the end in view of promoting people's welfare, security towards gender responsive and rights based sustainable development. Very big words. So, disaster resilient communities. The four pillars, and probably the closest definition you have there. DRR and CCA mainstreaming into national, local programs and plans, and that is for prevention and mitigation. Now, the USD has been doing hazard risk mapping, PAGASA for early warning systems, the ILG for the local DRRM offices, as well as staffing them. Preparedness, activities related to ensuring that people are prepared. Response will be carried out efficiently and effectively. Restoration of lifelines for response, and then for rehabilitation recovery, long-term recovery and prevention and mitigation. So it's really just a cycle. It doesn't stop, and probably There are no boundaries between the pillars. There are no defined lines, although there are dotted lines there. So for prevention and mitigation, I'll probably give more details in terms of how each pillar has been translated. But institution-wise, lead-wise, prevention and mitigation is being co-chaired by the OSD. Preparedness is being co-chaired by the ILP. Response by the SWD. And then rehabilitation recovery by NEDA. Alright, probably you can only make something concrete if you have the material complement towards what is being aimed at. So if you have the Ending Act of 2010, there should be that material complement. And probably a very, very good item to look at is the resources allocated towards those DRRM ideals. A series of slides I will be discussing next would try to give some sense to that. Okay, DRRM resources. Just a few mentioned there. You have the National Disaster Risk Reduction Management Fund. This is the previous calamity fund that we have renamed. Within it, supposedly, is the quick response fund that was before. Starting 2012, they have been releasing directly to certain core DRR institutions quick response funds for them to immediately act in terms of in times of disaster events. So you have the Local Disaster Risk Reduction Management Fund, about 5% of internal sources of revenue. Donor funds, adaptation risk financing assistance, assets of key government agencies, budgets of national line government agencies. Now the second to the last, assets of key government agencies play a very important role in terms of actually grounding DRR initiatives. As you all know, NDMC is just a body it's a body represented by so many departments. It is backed up by OCD, which has its organizational structure that is functional and actually supposedly OCD is empowered to carry out the monitoring and coordination of DRRM initiatives as enshrined in the law and as indicated in the NDRRM plan. But as suggested here, assets of key government agencies. Each pillar actually involves so many departments, so many institutions in government. And all of them have their own assets. All of them have their own tools toward contributing to a DRRM initiative. Take, for example, DPWH. In times of disaster events, DPWH is the one in charge of clearing the roads. And what do they use? They use their heavy equipment. Now, DPWH has a different mandate. So in terms of priority, you have a conflict there. Warm bodies, in terms of actual people going to the remote areas, helping individuals, helping those people in distress, you have the AFP, you have the NB, you have our uniformed personnel helping out. But the RR is not their primary mandate as well. So those are examples of how we can look at bettering, for example, the DRRM framework for the country. Budgets of national aligned with government agencies. Yearly, there are appropriations toward DRRM activities within institutions. So outside of for example, the ENTWIC fund, outside of the QRF, there are funds specially dedicated for DRR-related activities. We try to call some of those entries in the GAA of 2009-2016, and I think I'll be showing that later. Okay, let's go to the meat. So this is your entry fund from 2009-2016, your main source of funding for pre-disaster, disaster, and post-disaster activities. So you see there a very, very good trend. It has been increasing since the turn of the decade. And by 2016, you have there around 38.9 billion allocated for that fund. But that has to be, I guess, qualified because 80 billion of that is for Yolanda rehabilitation. So deduct 18 billion from there, you still have 20 billion. Still a big increase from the 14 billion we had in 2015. The same can be said for QRF, the Quick Response Fund, at the bottom. So by 2016, you had 6.2 billion. It's very substantial in terms of allocated figures, especially if you're going to look at where we started before the law was passed. The 2009 levels were very, very small compared to what we have now. So I guess looking at it that way, we are progressing, we are doing good, but we have enough resources. We have those big figures, but really, are those sufficient? Do we need more? That's probably a question that I cannot answer.
Sorry. Just a clarification of the original appropriations are identical from 2016 going back to 2012, but they diverge 2011 to. So just for us to understand what these line items
yes,
are.
Yes.
How did that happen?
Well, for both the Calamity Fund and for QRF, there are augmentations being done. So if you deplete the resource, yeah, there's no other recourse but to actually augment. So it's really just us trying to document that. Now, it's very evident for QRF. A lot of the core DRRM agencies are receiving fund augmentations in terms of quick response funds. DSWD for one has been received so many augmentations because, well, let's face it, DSWD right now is actually in charge of the most critical aspect of disaster response. Including now the 2017 level, you see there a bit of a drop. So just going back to the 38.9 billion that we had in 2016, 18 billion of that was for Yolanda rehabilitation. But still, from 20 billion to 15 billion is a bit of a drop. You have at the top some details. 1 billion insurance coverage for corporate facilities, 1.5 billion rehabilitation and reconstruction fund, QRF purpose 1 and 2. So that's another change in terms of how QRF is being released. Starting 2012, the few core institutions in government that received QRF actually received them directly. So these were funds that were built in their annual appropriations. But starting 2017, there were some changes. QRF now has been classified. There are two purposes, for example. You have purpose one and purpose two. One being referred to as probably the core institutions dealing with responsibilities, and that includes the SWD. I think what's a bit controversial there is the DPWH was classified under purpose two. So purpose two, you still have to request for the fund to be released to you. So instead of you having access to it directly, now you'll have to request it if you belong to that second category. But I guess it doesn't matter as long as you can have quick access to those funds, those resources, when you need them. Okay, just to break down the quick response funds from 2009-2017, not only the funds are changing in terms of amount, but also in terms of who received those funds. So you have a list there of the recipients of QRF from a very few four institutions initially receiving funds. Actually, in 2010, there were only three. But let's look at the 2012 level. In 2012, when you had direct releases of QRF, there were actually a handful of institutions just receiving QRF. But by 2016, it ballooned to so many entries there. 2017, cut down your number, and then NEA was included as a recipient. So that's probably something that's different from those previous years. And NEA was actually classified for purpose one. So it received directly the fund, as compared to those requiring requests for releases. QRF allocation, just a graphic illustration of what we have over the years, institutional shares, and annual total. Fund availment, very messy. The slide is very messy, but really, just look at, for example, the blue figure to your left, and then to the extreme right, the flowchart. Now for QRF, there are mechanisms in place in the field for damages to be assessed and eventually for QRF to be mobilized, for the resources to be mobilized within the different departments. So from the province, municipal, community, you have assessments, you have reports going to the region and the central offices. Now for the calamity fund or for the entering fund, it's still very straightforward. Implementing agency forwarding request to OCD as the secretariat of the NTMC, OCD forwarding to NTMC, and then the president approving it, DBM advising fund release in February. QRF is a standby fund for
calamity strike. So
yes. It's supposedly, since 2012, it's directly accessible. Among those institutions identified as core DRRF agencies. For example, in 2012, you had DepEd, you had DPWH, you had DND, OCD. Okay. So those are institutions that had the pleasure of having direct releases. And in times of disaster, they could immediately use those resources for DRR activities, response activities. Now, there is a bit of delay when it comes to requesting for the calamity fund or for the entry fund. So that's the main difference. But the entry fund is wider in terms of the spectrum of use, and it's bigger fund-wise. Okay, this is probably a good illustration to talk about. You'll see there, for example, the ILG, DMP, the SWD, the OSD, the core institutions managing the four pillars. The ILG for preparedness, DND, actually, and the SWD doing a very, very big part in terms of response, the OSD for mitigation. But look at the highlighted line there, which refers to the SWD. You see there how the SWD has taken a very, very big role in terms of our DRRM efforts. In the SWD's case, it's really about the response pillar, the response phase of DRR. So from 2010 to 2016, I think this is a testament to how the SWD was able to augment itself institution-wise, as well as it taking more responsibilities and it doing a bigger part in terms of aiding disaster-stricken communities. Okay. This one, this slide actually shows a different source of fund. This slide actually describes how climate change related expenses are allocated within the different departments and within the different priorities. Now, there is disagreement between CCC and DPM when it comes to tagging expenses related to climate change. And this depicts how the funds were used. So you can see there, the arrow pointing to water sufficiency and sustainable energy as the two main priorities where funds go to when it comes to climate change related expenses. You have there the different departments, the OSD, the ILG, the SWD, NEDA, OCD, DA, DNR, DWH, CCC. Major recipients of funds related to those climate change-related costs. So probably it's worth remembering that when you look at this, you see there, huge amounts of funds going into water sufficiency and sustainable energy for climate-related expenses. For this one, we just focus on the pillar needs, the OSD, the ILG, the SWD, NEDA, and then OCD. You see the focus there is human security, knowledge and capacity building. So I guess that's a very consistent way of using our resources. And you see there the focus of each group of initiatives, CC and DRRM. Institution-wise, I guess DOSD is able to move within the two dimensions, the two CC and DRR frameworks. probably it's because mitigation and prevention is a common trust for both ERR and climate change initiatives. On the other, ERR assets, as I mentioned earlier, warm bodies, transport equipment, heavy equipment, information communication equipment, staging areas, and evacuation centers, rescue equipment, food and non-food items, temporary shelters, baby beaches, other specialized equipment. I'll just go through the slides. I'll just present to you what we have in terms of documenting such assets within the different departments. Okay. Under DND, you have there the list of equipment descriptions. So you have aircrafts, C-130 helicopters, you have trucks, you have Navy vessels, and then you have strategic bases, staging areas as well, for so many DRR activities. So for NCR, North Luzon, Southern Luzon, Visayas, Eastern Mindanao, Western Mindanao, these are assets. Although it belongs to DND, these are assets that are very, very significant for ERR activities. More on those. So rubber boats, trucks, ambulances, engineering equipment, air support. Equipage status of teams. NCR, North Luzon, South Luzon, Central Visayas, Palawan, Eastern Mindanao, Western Mindanao. You have the number of teams, you have the PRRO equipment for flood and sea rescue. For OCD, it's really more of IEC equipment. PSWD. You have human resources, you have funds, you have logistics. If you go to DSWD, I think it's quite apparent that what they have now as an operation related to ERRM is a bit depressing. It's probably a product of years of augmentation, structure-wise, function-wise, and resource-wise. DPWH, your heavy equipment. Every time the trees fall, you have to clear the roads. Every time there are debris obstructing your major arteries, you have to clear those. You have to allow traffic to flow. And DPWH plays a very important role there. And that's why I guess QRF for DPWH is very, very useful. Necessary. So quick response equipment is what you have here. The average number of equipment per district, engineering office classification. I'm not going to the details. It's probably enough that you see that they have those. And then this is a very comprehensive table. It shows the number and status of all DRR-related assets within DPWH. Now, probably you won't be able to read some of the numbers there, but it's worth looking at the functionality of equipment. So, overall, 3,950 are operational out of 8,156. I think this figure was from 2013. I think they had a very good affinity program, and I guess the numbers now are a bit better. But you can see there that a lot can be done. So you have equipment, but you have a very, very few functional ones that can be used for ERR.
So, is that like dedicated
equipment
that cannot be used for other
No, no. As I mentioned earlier, DPWH, like other institutions involved in DRR, have their own priority mandates. So they use these to clear roads, to clear debris from the networks, to address landslides, for example, to help out citizens in distress. But they have their primary mandate.
So how are these assets counted as DRR-related?
Because they can be used for DRR-related activities. And essentially, during disaster events, DPWH is a very active entity that helps in terms of response, in terms of normalizing communities. So dual purpose, probably not only dual purpose, but these have a multitude of purposes.
To your knowledge, was the COA aware of this status?
In 2013?
Yes.
Well, then this is not a secret document. They actually, back then, they had this repleting program. And I went around there, I interviewed their division heads and got that sense. So they are going for something ideal, but if you're going to look at what is out there, it's a reality that equipment are aging and they have to be replenished, they have to be repaired, but probably in many cases it's better to actually replenish or refleet. So in terms of road equipment, 1,126 out of 2,366. DepEd. So if you're talking about DepEd, it's really about you talking of the infrastructure of schools and most importantly the teachers, your work buddies. Teachers are unsung heroes in times of elections. But in many cases, also in times of capacity building, in times of helping out communities in distress. Okay. I'll just go through institutional grounding and then probably mention some institutional related insights. As I mentioned earlier, four pillars. Then you have your co-chairs, DOSD for disaster prevention and mitigation, DILG for disaster preparedness, DSWD for disaster response, NEDA for disaster rehabilitation recovery. They have their key members, as mentioned there. Now, in trying to go into details in terms of grounding, it's really quite difficult to get detailed information from each institution involved.